Welcome to Life Church Panania. Thank you for joining us and thank you for allowing us to join you. It's great to be with you as we worship our great God and Saviour. We'll be guiding you through our time together today. I'm Ian.
And I'm Eleanor.
And our theme for today is the best of my life is the rest of my life. The good news is that things are going to get better and better. And we find that in our text for today from 1 Peter chapter 4. So a couple of questions. How long will I live? And what is God's will for my life? These are key questions. And we'll find that our text today addresses both of those. Now, before we start, have you printed out your Go Deeper sheet for those of you who like to follow the sermon outline? And here we have a set of questions for those of you who want to take these thoughts a little deeper if you'd like to join us on Wednesday night. Also, we'll be celebrating the Lord's Supper today. So do you have something that you can use for your bread and your wine? Ready to roll? Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your love and grace and mercy and generosity towards us. Oh, help us to understand more of how great you are, how desperately we need you, and guide us that we might become all that you have saved us and are transforming us to become, and use our time together now to accomplish that end, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. In becoming all that we need to be, all that God wants for us to be, we have this wonderful song, I Am Resolved. I'm not going to stop where I am. I'm resolved to move forward to become all that God has got for me. Sing it like you mean it. I am resolved. Amen. I am resolved to keep on becoming all that God wants for me to be. Now, news, we're completely locked down in New South Wales, but we still have some announcements anyway. Tomorrow night is Hour of Power. We can't get together to pray, but we can pray nonetheless. So can I ask you that somewhere in that hour, you take a little time to pray, to join the rest of us, all praying in our separate private locations. We can pray, and this unites our prayers together. It will be an hour of power. And then on Wednesday, we will be able to at least see one another and talk to one another on our various devices. So here's my private email on the bottom of the screen. If you'd like to be part of asking and answering the questions on our Go Deeper sheet, then if you send me an email or let me know somehow, then I will send you an invitation just before 7:30 on Wednesday. Although we're shut down, the bills still need to be paid. And if you'd like to support us, and thank you for all those who do, then the top account BSB and number will enable you to support the broad ministry of the church. And when we are able to get across to Myanmar with funds, then the bottom account number will enable us to do that. But of course, we can't do anything without prayer. So let's bow in prayer now. Almighty God, we thank you that you are in charge. When it looks like man or disease or circumstances or events or people get in the way, thank you that nothing takes you by surprise and already you have a better contingency plan. Save us from being frustrated about what we can't do and can't achieve, so that we might lay hold of your hand and have you guide us, even carry us, into the better future that you've got in store for us. Thank you that we can rely upon you. And we want to bring to you ourselves and one another with all of our needs. We lift before you those with physical needs, with health and mental health. We bring before you those who struggle in their relationships and the difficulties of getting on with some people. But we ask beyond that we would reach higher goals. Oh Lord, pour yourself into our thinking so that we would think your thoughts, into our soul that we would desire what you desire, into our spirit that we would live in the abundance of walking in the Spirit. So guide all that we are becoming in you, for we ask it in our Redeemer's name, Jesus. Amen. We're now in the center of our service, and the center part for all that we do revolves around Jesus. We read in coming to the Lord's table, whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So everyone ought to examine themselves. So notice what we're looking at. We're looking back to the cross. We're looking forward till he comes. And we're looking inward to examine ourselves. For we find that we are the ones for whom Christ died. It's for our salvation that he was raised again and is coming again. It's only right that we look at ourselves and find that we are at the center of God's plan. Well, thank you, Lord, for all that you've done. So Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to those who are his friends, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." So take your bread, break it, and eat it now, remembering that Jesus gave his life for you so that you could be free of sin and free for righteousness. Thank you, Lord. Then he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." Now here is Jesus looking to what the future holds for you and me. Not the old covenant of sacrifice, but the new covenant of one sacrifice forever and sealed so that we could live in eternity in the life of Christ. As Jesus took the cup, take your cup. And as you drink it right now, remember Jesus gave his life for you. Heavenly Father, thank you for the Savior that we have. Thank you for his body broken on the cross that sin might be dealt with in our lives. Thank you for his blood poured out so that we might have new life in him. Oh Lord, now guide us that we would live this life, this death to self and sin, resurrection to life eternal and abundant, so that we might glorify you in all that we are becoming in Christ. For we ask in his name. Amen. Here is our song of response. Oh, that we would be refined to be the pure, holy people that God saved us to be. Let's sing.
Refine my heart.
Thank you, Lord, for the refining you're doing in our lives. And now we come to open God's word. Our text for today comes from 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 1 through 6.
Hear the word of the Lord. Since Christ suffered in his body, arm yourselves with the same resolve, because anyone who has suffered in his body is done with sin. Consequently, he does not live out his remaining time on earth for human passions, but for the will of God. For you have spent enough time in the past carrying out the same desires as the Gentiles, living in debauchery, lust, drunkenness, orgies, carousing, and detestable idolatry. Because of this, they consider it strange of you not to plunge with them into the same flood of reckless indiscretion, and they heap abuse on you. But they will have to give an account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. That is why the gospel was preached even to those who are now dead, so that they might be judged as men in the flesh, but live according to God in the spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The best part of my life is still in front of me. The best part of my life is the rest of my life, and it's yet to come. We have a quote from Richard Gere, not a man of faith, but what he said is quite true anyway. He said, "I'm old, but I'm forever young at heart." Know that you are the perfect age. Each year is special and precious. You can only live it once. Do not regret growing older. It's a privilege denied to many. So the question for us is, how do we grow older? How do we take the next step in ways that are a blessing to us and to others? Our text for today includes these words. Consequently, he does not live out his remaining time on earth for human passions, but for the will of God. There's so much in that. Let's explore what that means. We're going to unpack it two verses at a time. And the first thing we find is the best life is lived in an outward direction, starting from the inside and working out. Works like this. Since Christ suffered in his body, arm yourselves with the same resolve. So for your note takers, inwardly, I deal with my Savior. And first and foremost, Jesus is there for me to engage with. And to connect with our text, let this mind be in you that was also in Christ. And not only that, the one who has suffered in his body is done with sin. So inwardly I deal with my Savior, outwardly I deal with my sin. It's got to work from the inside out. We have this picture of what we all look like from 1 Thessalonians 5. We are made up of spirit, soul, and body. The spirit is that inner part, that eternal part of it, that part that connects with God. The soul is our mind, our temperament, our personality, our thinking, and our body is the package that carries all of these forward. We all begin in the same place. We all begin spiritually dead. Our spirit is dead, even though the rest of us is very much alive. And time again, we're told in Scripture, you were dead in your trespasses and sins. And then we have a problem because sin in the core of us expands and starts to take over in other ways. Sin becomes sins, and various sins affect us each differently. We all have different ways of expressing sin. But we want to change. And the Holy Spirit comes in and death is turned to life. The life of Christ comes in with the Holy Spirit who indwells our spirit. We're changed from death to life. But notice what hasn't changed. We still have issues. We still have things we need to deal with. We still have sins that we need to repent of and transform. And that's exactly what the Holy Spirit does. He helps us work on various things that are wrong in our lives so that we can transform them and overcome them. And when we get serious about holiness, then the Holy Spirit helps us to deal with our various sins. And we can be more or less successful depending on the level of maturity that we take in dealing with ourselves. And if we partner with the Holy Spirit, then we can achieve a great level of maturity. Now, it's also possible for non-Christians to also be mature or immature. And the sins that we have are different for each of us, and they depend so much on the circumstances in which we were raised, the parenting that we received, the friendships that we established, the environment in which we moved. And then for those who are churched, look at the one on the left, churched but unsaved, still spiritually dead, but church has been good for a bit in that it helps provide an environment to overcome many sins. Someone who is saved on the right-hand side, but unchurched and without the supportive environment of other believers, finds going tough. That's why we need to be both saved and engaged in an environment that's helpful. It works like this. In coming to Christ, we were pre-churched, and then we discovered, hey, there is a better way to live, and it's found in Christ. And it's possible to be churched, and unfortunately, if we're only church, it's possible to be de-church and drop out of the church scene without ever being saved. That's why when we find Jesus, we need to find his way, not just a way. And his way is the way of sanctification. It's the way of holiness. It's the way that takes us ever upward. Now, our text says, consequently. That means that what are the consequences of discovering Jesus? It's, first of all, that we do not live out our remaining time just pursuing our human, earthly passions. Rather, the second consequence is that we start living a better life, a godly life for the will of God. So, the remaining time that we've got, let's ask ourselves, how much time have I got left? How much time have I been given? Is there a set amount? Let's grab some scriptures to find the answer to those questions. First of all, we have, Lord, remind me how brief my time on earth will be. Remind me that my days are numbered and how fleeting my life is. So we have a set amount of time, and that time is not long, however long that is. And we need to remember that we need to work on the spiritual quality of our life, and at the same time, without realizing it, we're adding to the chronological length of our life when we choose well. So we pray, teach us to number our days so that we can gain a heart of wisdom. Look at God's point of view of us. Your eyes saw me before I was born. All my days were written in your book, and you ordained them for me, even before one of them came to be. The Lord knows how long we've got, even though we don't. So what happens is, the fear of the Lord prolongs life, but the years of the wicked will be short. We've got a set amount of time, and if we are wicked, if we're evil, if we are foolish, then we can shorten that time. War and illness and poor lifestyle choices will shorten our lives. But the fear of the Lord gives us the maximum length that we can possibly have because we are walking with him and developing the best possible lifestyle. And it's this quality of life that comes out here. Whoever desires to love life and see good days, that's quality of life. How do you do that? Let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. We speak and create with our words the quality of life that we want to live. So if we speak bitterness and anger and hatred and revenge, That's not quality of life. It's what we create with our words. But if we speak words of thanksgiving and joy, that's a real quality of life. Let's, in this section, leave the last word to Jesus. Who of you, by being worried, can add a single hour to his life? You know, you've perhaps heard the modern proverb, he worried himself into an early grave. Well, Jesus reversed all that years ago. Worrying doesn't add a single hour to our lives. So your remaining time, you've got a time, and it's up to you to make the most of whatever time that might be. The other thing that we see in this one verse is not just how much time that we've got, but what is God's will for us? Now, we've explored God's will before, but today we're going to go a bit deeper and pursue just a little more about knowing God's will. Let's start with this, God's commanded will. This is a general statement. This is God's will for everybody, whoever they are. Excuse me. It begins with, teach me to do your will, for you are my God. May your good spirit lead me on level ground. So we can know God's will, and we can ask for the wisdom to be able to know God's will. Let's start with the negative. What is not God's will? It is not the Lord's will for anyone to perish. So if we reverse that, we'll know what God's will is. And that's the second line. So it's God's will for everyone to come to repentance. Instead of perishing, going to hell, you can repent and change your destination. That's God's will for you. Repent and be saved. This is the will of God, your holiness. And then there's several verses giving some practical examples of what that looks like. And then it ends with, God has not called us to impurity, but to holiness. So God's will is we live a holy lifestyle. This is the choices that we are making all the time. Part of the good choices is give thanks within every circumstance, because this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. This is how we are creating our circumstances by the words that we speak. Now, not every circumstance is good, and you can't say thank you for bad circumstances, but within every circumstance, you can look for and find something that is worth giving thanks for. And we round up with this one. The will of God is that by doing good, you may silence the ignorance of foolish people. Now, it does not say that by doing good, you will silence foolish people. They will still be foolish. But by doing good, you will silence the ignorance of foolish people. They will still be foolish, but they won't have a legitimate reason for their ignorance, because you and the good that you do show them up. Now, that's God's general will. Now, sometimes there is things that are specific for individuals. This is God's circumstantial will. What is your circumstance that is unique to you, and God is at work in that? Here's a couple of examples. God's will is not specified here, but we can find it within this example. Who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? And Jesus' answer is, neither this man nor his parents sinned, but this happened so that the works of God could be displayed in him. Any disability or any unfortunate circumstance we have is not God punishing you. It is not God punishing you. God is love and grace and mercy and goodness and kindness. He's not here to punish you. So no one sinned that this fellow was born blind. But this was the circumstance in which he found himself so that God could work within that circumstance and bring about his own glory through that. We can be a bit more specific than that. Paul's on a missionary journey, and as he left, he said, I will come back to you if God is willing. And he set sail from Ephesus. Now, he didn't know whether he'd come back or not. He didn't know what his circumstances would be. And sometimes we just have to say, I don't know what the answer is going to be. I don't know where I'm going to go. I don't know where I'm going to end up. But if it's God's will, I will take this path. Now, we have an earlier example of them doing that. The Holy Spirit prevented them from speaking the word in the province of Asia. And so they traveled through the region of Phrygia and Galatia. Here they had a plan. The plan didn't work because God had shut the door on Asia and they needed to go in a different direction. They went wherever they wanted to go, but there was a point where God shut the door, and in response, they chose a different direction. It wasn't a bad direction. It wasn't a grief. It was just, that plan doesn't work. We will do something else because God's hand is in it. And it is better, if it's God's will, here's another if it's God's will to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. There are some times when God will ask you to walk a difficult pathway. Now, we all face difficulties and greater or lesser degrees, so it seems from a human viewpoint. And sometimes you'll be asked to walk a pathway of suffering, but God will be in that with you, for you, and good will come out of that. So that's a very quick skim over verses 1 and 2, and where we find that the best life that we can live is lived in an outward direction, from the inside out, from the Holy Spirit coming within, dealing with our sin, and helping us to make wise choices in moving into the best part of life. That's the best life. Now, let's move into the next couple of verses. The best life is lived in a forward direction. I need to get out of this place where I am now and move into the next step, the next phase of life, the next part of my life's pathway. But this verse opens up by saying, you've spent enough time in the past. So the first thing I need to do is repent of the negative things, the bad things, the awful things, the sinful things, the debilitating things of my past. Let go of them. Don't let them hold you by holding on to them. All of us have done wrong things, and all of us have had wrong things done to us. We cannot let that hold us back and trap us. My past describes me, but does not define me. Yes, our experiences that we've all been through in the past, the experiences that are unique to you, that's part of your story, your journey, your experience. But that's not entirely who you are. It's just what you've been through to take you to a place that is going to make you better than you are now. And because of this, they find it strange that you don't plunge into the same flood of reckless indiscretion. This is us redirecting our future, choosing a better future. Don't get stuck in the past. What happened in the past, lots of people enjoyed it. You might have enjoyed it, but don't live there. Move on into a better place. Redirect your future. Some of you are familiar with this, and what I'm going to show you is based on Abraham Maslow's hierarchy of needs, a little thing he invented in 1943. Right at the base, there is survival needs that we have. You need air more than anything else. Then you need water. Then you need food and shelter. And there are your security needs, you know, the resources to have an income. You need good health. You need those things. The focus on these two lower levels is on objects. It's on tasks. It's on the body in terms of spirit, soul, and body. This is the body that we're focusing in on. The next two are, first of all, I need support. I need friends. I need connections. I need to belong somewhere so that I'm not just an individual. And these are building up one on top of the other. And with that, I need success. I need to be able to do something that will give me the earn me the respect and the recognition of the team of friends and the group to whom I belong. This is where the focus is on people and on relationships. And here the emphasis is moves from the body to the soul. But there's more, of course. And as we move up, there's self-actualization. This is where I'm no longer dependent on others to pat me on the head, but rather I choose to be the best that I can be, whether other people recognize it or not. And the highest pinnacle to which I can reach is spiritual. This is where I repent of all the things that could hold me back. I live by faith in God. I live life to the full. I live the abundant life that is Christ in me and living all that I can possibly be. And here the focus is on myself and independence of others so that I can be all that God wants me to be. And the focus here is on the Spirit. All of them are important. All of them are necessary. And yes, they all grow in that order, more or less. There's overlaps. But when we pray, have you noticed that we tend to pray the bottom half of the pyramid more than anything else? We pray about income, we pray about health, and we pray about where we live and the care of others. And rightly so, we should be praying those sorts of things. But we need to pray all of the pyramid. We need to pray more than just the basics for one another and the basics for ourselves. Let me give you an example of how you can pray the top half of the pyramid, because the prayers in Scripture tend to do just that. Here's just one example. I've not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation in your knowledge of Him. I ask that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened, so that you may know the hope of His calling, the riches of His glorious inheritance in the saints, and the surpassing greatness of His power to us who believe. This is praying the top end of the pyramid. Don't neglect all that you can be and all that God wants you to be and all that God's equipped you to be to help others to rise up as well and do their own journey. So the best life is lived not only from the inside out, but lived in this forward direction, moving beyond where we were, beyond our past, beyond our limitations, into the bigger and better that God has got for us. No matter what age or stage you're at, you're still moving forward and growing in holiness. And then there's one more thing in the last couple of verses. The best life is lived in an upward direction. We're not just moving, but we are moving in a particular direction. We're moving upward. And we find that in verses 5 and 6, where there is the recognition that when we get to the end of life, we need to give an account. And so I live accountable to the Son. And if you live that way every day, then it won't be a drama when you find you're face to face with Him and ask to give an account. Let's think about this accountability at the end of life. We know that each of us will give an account of himself to God, remembering that God is holy and righteous, and that's the standard by which we are going to be measured when we give an account. But the interesting thing is the Father judges no one. He's assigned all judgment to the Son. So Jesus is not only Savior, He is also the coming judge. And He, the Father, has given Him, the Son, authority to execute judgment. And why? Because He is the Son of Man, not the Son of God, although He is that. His authority to be judge is because He is one of us. He's the Son of Man. And he, the Father, has set a day when he will judge the world in justice. But again, notice he will do it by the man he has appointed. And the justice is he has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead. The very fact that Jesus is a real person who really died and who really came back from the dead is the guarantee that there is life after death, and we are therefore accountable for what we've done in our lives when we face the God of eternity. We find too that we are to live in this life according to God in the Spirit. That's why we're not only living, knowing we're accountable to the Son, but living according to the Holy Spirit, who's come to dwell in our spirit and guide us from the inside out. And so look at the words that connect both of these texts together. Our text is in the Spirit, and this cross-reference says, if we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit who is to be the life that we live, the breath that we breathe, the direction that we move. Everything is done in and through God partnering with us and us partnering with him. And so I say, walk in the Spirit and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. All the problems in our text of verses 3 and 4, the way that you used to live, once you start walking in the Spirit and living the godly life, those desires start to fall away. The result is the righteous standard of the law can be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but who walk according to the Spirit. And here we are back to our text. Live according to God in the Spirit. That's why God's given you the Spirit, so that you can live this higher quality, this better quality of life, so that the rest of your life can be the best of your life. So out of these verses, we again reiterate, the best life is lived in an upward direction. Keep looking up, keep moving up. So what we have here is, consequently, I do not live out my remaining time on earth for human passions of the past, but I live for the will of God, for I have spent enough time in the past carrying out the same desires of the Gentiles. Now it's time for change. Now it's time for renewal. Now it's time for the best of life to begin. Your time as a caterpillar has expired. Your wings are ready. Are you ready to fly? The best of your life is ahead. The best of your life is the rest of your life. So let me pray for you. Father, thank you for the Holy Spirit who comes to dwell within us when we repent of our sin and open ourselves up to what you want to do in our lives. And now we ask that as we take this journey around the bend and into the unknown, we thank you that we can do it with the confidence that the best is the rest. And we rest in you. In Jesus we thank you. Amen. This is a little statement saying we're copyright compliant. There are lots of questions, well, half a dozen questions, that you can ask yourself, or better still, ask someone else, or, if you'd like, be part of our Wednesday night Go Deeper group, and we'll ask them of each other. And we hope that you will be able to join us when we're allowed back together again after COVID lockdown. But remember, the best of my life is indeed the rest of my life. Here is our song with which we close. I'm going to follow you, Jesus, wherever that might be, whatever pathway that might be, I'm going to follow you.
You got me following you, Mom.
Where are we going? The best of my life is the rest of my life. We've got a great future ahead of us. Thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for us. And now we ask that the life of Jesus would flood into us, flood through us, and enable us to make the rest of our lives the best of our lives. We ask it in his name. Amen. So thank you for joining us today for church. Thank you for allowing us to guide you in this time of worship. And I pray that now God will guide you in a life of worship. If you liked what you've seen and experienced today, please like us, share us. You can find us in our website, lifechurchpanania.org. You might have found us on Facebook. You can do so there. And we also have a YouTube channel, and you can find more of the services there. So until next time, thank you for joining us, and God bless you.